Now it's time for one of our favorite parts of the conference, the moment we get to hear from some of the world's premier CF doctors and researchers about the latest in science. I hope you take pride that it is because of your support of our mission that we have come as far as we have. It is now my pleasure to welcome back to the stage the inspirational leader of our team, Dr. Mike Boyle, along with our panelists.
I just want to celebrate, yeah, yeah, another day of living. Yeah, I just want to celebrate another day of living.
Actually, I'm going to wait you up in just a second here. We got an eager group. They're fantastic. So good morning, everybody. It's great to see everybody. And Rob, thank you for your words. The only thing, though, is that you can't give me the sniffles before I come up on stage. That's just not fair. Well, this is always one of our favorite parts of the meeting, and really have a special session for you this morning. And before I do, I want to just to highlight a couple of those little pearls that I told you about, that to talk about the progress that we're making. I shared yesterday about the median predicted survival being up to 53 years of age. And there's another number that actually is a number that I want you to keep in mind as a sign of progress. And that is, ever since I started in cystic fibrosis in the mid-90s, and probably for everybody here, whenever we were asked, how many people are there in the United States with cystic fibrosis? The number was always the same. We said around 30,000, right? Probably most of you know that number, around 30,000. And that's because, unfortunately, what was happening is, yes, new people were being born with CF, but we were losing people at about the same rate, right? Well, I want to announce something else that I think will really highlight what a change is. So we'd say 30,000 in the U.S., we'd say it's about 70,000 worldwide. And that's been the answer for forever. And but recently, we started seeing some changes in the trends over the last couple of years. And Bruce Marshall and the registry team started looking and these numbers, seeing these trends. So I want to give you the new correct answer for that. So when you're asked now how many people in the United States have cystic fibrosis, the answer is nearly 40,000. So, and over 100,000 worldwide, about 105,000 worldwide. So again, this just shows the change, right? So we have people living longer. The same number of people with CF are being born, but they're doing so much better. So again, a real tangible sign of progress and another little tool in your arsenal when you're telling the CF story. That combine that with that 60% number. Remember I said that we're getting closer and closer to 60% of individuals with CF being adults. Tells a fantastic story, and it's going to highlight some of the themes you're going to hear today from the team. Actually, I wanted to make sure I welcomed everybody online as well. So welcome. I'm sorry that I didn't acknowledge you. We definitely feel like you're part of this as well. So thank you for being here. So we're going to switch now to the care and cure update. And there's three people that I'm really looking forward to you meeting. And part of this is because obviously we're excited about telling the story of all the progress that's been going on. We got a couple of years worth of progress to be highlighting. But also because I wanted you to meet some new people on the team, people that maybe you haven't heard from in the past as much. That there's going to be three themes today. We're going to do obviously our care and our cure sections, and we're going to have three speakers, but there's going to be some themes. We're going to actually start at the top with a growing number of adults, really thinking about how we're going to make sure we create the right care system for the future. We're trying to think ahead, right? So yes, we think all the time about the cure part, but we have an entire dedicated team that focuses on saying, how are we going to get the best care at the centers? How do we actually start preparing now to be able to deliver the service and to support the care teams for the adults and increasingly healthy, hopefully pediatric patients as well? So we're going to start off with that. And then the second theme is you're going to hear quite a bit about taking on challenges, right? So Trikafta, absolutely fantastic, a great story. But there are still a lot of challenges despite Trikafta, right? That can be with infections. the whole idea here, and also the other part is understanding. So it's the things that are challenges, but also understanding the effects of Trikafta better. So that's going to be another theme you're going to hear throughout. And then the last theme, obviously, is our ultimate dream, the dream that we all share, which is transformative therapy for everybody with CF, no matter what the mutation, and then a true cure for everyone. So you're going to hear those three themes today. And I'm going to start by introducing our first speaker today. And actually, you know what? Why don't we go ahead and greet you guys up here. We'll set you up. So So we're going to hear today from three speakers. I'll introduce them in more detail when they come, but it's Dr. Whitney Brown, Dr. J.P. Clancy, and Dr. Stephen Rowe. And like I said, there are some new faces in some ways. They're really well known to the CF community, but not perhaps to you. So one of the things I look forward to, I guess maybe that fourth theme, is just realizing how we're building a team for the future, a team that's going to be with us for the years ahead. Now, our first speaker today is Dr. Whitney Brown, but I'm going to acknowledge somebody first, because usually in this place, Dr. Bruce Marshall comes up and tells us all about care, right? And we love Bruce. We're so great. Bruce is the person who's led the registry for years and years, and he has a whole team. Dr. Al Farrow is a part of his team as well, who helps lead our transplant initiative. But we wanted to introduce a new face. But the reason I wanted to particularly call out Dr. Marshall is because I believe on Monday is his 20th anniversary at the CF Foundation. And he is that. So Bruce, can you stand up? Stand up. Bruce, you know, he's quiet. He's a quiet dynamo behind the scenes, but really oversees all the registry as well as all the care network. He's just had an incredible influence. So Bruce, thank you. Thank you for that. Our first speaker to talk about care is actually Dr. Whitney Brown, somebody we couldn't be more excited about. She joined the CF Foundation in July of 2021 as a Senior Director of Clinical Affairs. She supports the Care Center Network and thinking about how to create that care for the future, right? Here's the thing is she is an experienced CF care provider as well as a lung transplant physician at Inova Fairfax Hospital. She continues to see patients there. We think this is a great balance of continuing to stay active with care and with lung transplant care and the day-to-day, but then also being with us to help shape that model for the future. So Dr. Brown, thank you. Can you come join us and tell us about care? No.
Good morning. Good morning to those online and in the room. And I'm fortunate to have my voice this morning. And maybe I didn't have as much fun last night, but and I got the mic where I need to be. I'm so honored to be a part of this event, and I can feel the warmth and the connection, and it's really quite energizing. So thank you for having me. So today, this network that's cohesive, because this was a time when connection at the care center level was critically important, a sense of belonging to something larger than just the care center and connecting with peers across the country who were facing the same challenges with delivering CF care. And for patients, really what the goal is when seeking care at these specialized centers is to, number one, receive very specialized expert care collected in certain hubs, concentrated. The second would be also to develop the same feeling of belonging and connection that we are promoting in our network. We're promoting that with the multidisciplinary teams and the relationships that people have the opportunity to build at the care centers. And then lastly, patients have the opportunity to participate in our patient registry, which really fuels where we're going to place resources, invest money in research, and shows us what's happening across the country. So that leads in very nicely to what is the CF patient registry. You guys see all the graphs that are presented each year and all the statistics that we share, and this comes from people with CF and their families agreeing to share their data with us. And it's critically important, like I said, for many reasons, and we're grateful that people are able to do this at the care centers. And I wanted to highlight, until this year, I wasn't aware that there are actually three major reports that the registry team puts out each year. We've always heard about, on the right there, the annual data report, which comes out in the North American CF Conference and where most of our data figures come from. But in the middle there, what I really think is cool and something that I plan to use more is this highlights report. I don't know if you guys have seen it, but it's the two-pager talking about how to really promote an advocacy and our connections day-to-day in the elevator. This is where we get those high-level messages about what's happening across the country. It's a two-pager. It came out last month, and I encourage you to check it out. And then on the program level, all the way to the left, this is something I appreciate working at the ANOVA Care Center, is we can get a report of just our data that shows what's happening in our patient population so that we can reflect against national trends and benchmark against what are the national averages across the country, and then and really come up with our strengths, what are we doing well, and then really where do we want to invest quality improvement efforts to bolster our care compared with our peers. And so when we talk about the registry, all of the data comes from clinic visits. So when people come to clinic, that's when we have the opportunity to collect data. And as we know, the last 3 years has been, 2.5 years has been different. And so I wanted to step through, and this is in this year's annual data report, it's a sneak peek. I wanted to step through what's been happening in terms of visits over the last 3 years. And this is a graph of the number of encounters each month for people with CF in the registry. And it starts in January of 2019, which is kind of the steady state before the world changed, and then it runs all the way through last year. So what you can see in the blue line on top is those are traditional in-person CF clinic visits, and those were generally hovering above 10,000 a month. And then down at the bottom in red, you can see that these are non-clinic visits, what are defined as telephone or video visits, what we're going to term telehealth for intensive purposes. And you can see that was existing at a very low level in early 2019. And if we sort of march forward there, we know in October 2019, something huge happened, obviously, with the approval of Trikafta for people 12 years and up. And we had about 4 or 5 months with that in mind before the world blew up. And so then we see, of course, that big spike up in the red line, which is when the pandemic hit and the care teams across the country and people with CF and their families had to quickly learn how to do telehealth. And we were up for the challenge, and you can see that lots of care was provided over telehealth and sort of up and down with the different pandemic transmission rates. Telehealth has been one of the tools that has allowed us to continue to provide that seamless care. And then by the end of last year, you can see down in the red, it's sort of telehealth has reached a new steady state, which is not as high as it was, but it is clearly part of the picture and appears to be here to stay at probably a low level. So that's how we collected the data. So the next couple slides are the takeaways from that highlights report, which I'm going to plug again. And Dr. Boyle already spoke about this, but we are thrilled about the continued increase in this trajectory of median predicted survival. And this is up to age 53 and a trend, again, that we expect to continue. Not only, though, are people living longer lives with CF, people are living fuller lives with CF. And this is this is what's been termed the Trikafta baby boom, and I think a lot of you saw this data last year. But the number of pregnancies started to uptick again in that 2019 period when so much change happened, and then really exploded in 2020 and 2021, above 600 and increase last year compared to the year before. And that is actually in contrast to the U.S. birth rate, which went down during 2020, 2021. So for all of us that are said, oh, no, it's just because people were at home and had more time on their hands. That's not the case. That's not the case. And what we think it reflects is improved health status, people daring to dream, fulfilling those dreams, and increased fertility for women who are fortunate enough to be on Trikafta. So we know people are living longer, and we know more people are having families, but what is not happening as much is lung transplantation. And this is these are five-year increments across, so the x-axis is a little different. So we can see that over time it's been kind of growing, sort of mid-200s was what it was for the last the last 5 years prior to 2019. And then in 2019, similar pattern from pregnancies, is that it started, the number started to go down as pregnancies started to go up. And then really, number of transplants fell 2020, 2021, only 52 last year. So that is amazing. And I think you guys have maybe heard me say this before, but even as a lung transplant doctor, if we're in the business of putting us out of business, that's a good, you know, that's just fine for me. So, but it was interesting. I showed one of my patients this figure in clinic, and to just generate excitement, I showed the highlights report, and he said, "Well, does that mean that people with CF are not getting the lungs they need because people with COVID are getting the lung transplants?" And I said, "Well, good question." But what I want to point out is that the trajectory down is paralleled by the wait list. People were removed off the wait list, so it reflects a decreased need, not a decreased access. And in fact, yesterday I looked on the UNOS website to see how many people are waiting right now for a lung transplant listed, and there's 37 as of yesterday in UNOS. So this is, again, a decreased need, but we are not done. We are not backing down on our commitment to lung transplant. And we'll hear more from Dr. Al Farrow and the exciting research that's being done. But we know over 1,600 people in the country are living after a lung transplant with CF now. And we continue to have a high level commitment to them. And also to people with advanced lung disease that either previously met the definition of advanced lung disease and maybe have had some improvements and are hovering in that area now. But we need more time in the future to see what's going to happen, and we want to make sure that we are prepared with the tools to deliver the highest quality transplants with the best outcomes when and if the need comes. So we talked a lot about rosy things and great things that have been happening during the pandemic, but this is one that I think we're all acutely aware of, is that mental health has suffered, suffered for everyone in the country, and this is paralleled in the registry. And so this sort of points out an area where we need to really focus in on, and we've taken note and we're taking action. But we can see here that this is based on the screening that happens in at the multidisciplinary clinics, is that in 2019 versus 2021, more people with CF over the age of 12 reporting depression and anxiety to their care teams. And again, that's I don't think that's surprising given the circumstances. It's multifactorial. And the biggest word that comes to me is uncertainty. And I think that that's what is driving a lot of this for a lot of Americans, but for people with CF in particular. And so we are intensely focused on this, and I invite you to visit the breakout sessions on mental health this afternoon. And I think this is a kind of a holistic diagram that I put together that helps me think about CF care, and I hope it's helpful for you. I think the opportunity, because people are we're having less exacerbations during the last couple of years, lung health and overall hospitalizations are down. It's given me the opportunity, at least, to have more conversations and think outside of just the lungs when I'm seeing people in clinic. Really get to talk to people about what they're living with day to day in terms of complications of CF, and how we can and will continue to support that on the care side. And so, you know, first and foremost, mental health, since we just mentioned that. And I just wanted to make you guys aware, in July of 2020, each care center program receives a subsidy, a grant from the foundation each year. But in July of 2020, there was a line item that was added that is specifically for mental health. And it's use it or lose it for mental health. It can't be used for anything else. And that, I think, really highlights the commitment, and that will continue into the future. And how each program chooses to use that money, whether it's for enhanced social worker, a mental health coordinator, whatever the label is, the point is to prevent, screen, and intervene with mental health issues when we come in contact with them in the CF clinic. So I think that's one to highlight. And that has come up a lot in the last year in clinic, and I think around the country. GI health and endocrine health. So those, I think we all are critically aware that finding specialists knowledgeable in CF for those other complications can be quite a challenge. And that's the whole idea of the Care Center Network, is to develop and encourage that challenge. I mean, that expertise locally. And so we have, I just want to point out that there are two sort of parallel grants or programs that we run to support and entice people early in their career to come into cystic fibrosis. And one is for endocrinologists called Envision, and the other is for gastroenterologists called Digest. And those are three-year programs, again, for people early in their career to, and it covers salary support, so they can kind of have time carved out to think about and see people with CF. It involves mentorship, so they're paired up with senior mentors in the field, and then travel money to North American CF Conference, so they can really soak in the whole experience. And we're hoping by doing that, and we have data, that they come, they get to know the CF community, and they want to stay. And then lastly, reproductive health, as we, you know, again, pertaining back to more families, more thinking about parenthood and pregnancy. We have a lot of work going on in the space, and actually Dr. Jennifer Taylor Kauser here in the audience is leading a work group, both looking at women's health in particular, and then reproductive health on a larger scale about what are the gaps, what do we need to invest our money. And we know that we are going to have to partner more with OBGYNs and fertility specialists to bring them up to speed and learn together to take care of people having families with CF. So the future is very bright, and I think the theme that keeps resonating is continued growth. Growth and aging of the population. And with this, this is a good problem to have, but with this, we're going to encounter some issues with aging and having families that we need to be prepared for. And then lastly, telehealth appears to be here to stay in some degree. And so whether that, it's not replacing a traditional CF clinic, but whether that's to help deliver mental health care or help to connect faster with people who are sick so we can make a plan, I think it's a great platform as an option to use moving forward. And this again is that the figure about the growing adult population. And the one last program I wanted to point out is something that's been in existence since 2008, but we talked about bringing endocrinologists and GI specialists into the fold, but we really need more CFologists or CF doctors to take care of adults as we look towards the future. And this program does just that. It's the Program for Adult Care Excellence, or PACE. Again, that three-year salary support for people early in their career, mentorship, and travel. And this really has had a great success rate, and with 126 awards to date, and we just received a new batch of applications, and with the majority, three-quarters of those staying in CF after the three-year award ends, and most of those in leadership positions. So that is a really good return on investment. So I'll just end with highlighting that we are trying to strike the right balance between meeting people where they are now and what they need in terms of living life day-to-day with CF, but also planning towards the future. And see, these are some of the concepts that we're thinking about as we look towards the future. And I think that the thing that resonates in my mind that will not change in this ever-changing world, that will not change, is the fact that our care center network and the care that we facilitate is data-driven, thank you to the registry, and based in trust-based relationships. As Melanie highlighted yesterday, there's nothing without humanity, and data and humanity together will bode us well for the future, and those will not change. So I'm excited as we look toward the future, and I think we're going to hear more about that from our next two speakers. Thank you.
Thank you, Whitney. Have a seat. Thank you. So Whitney, thank you. There's something comforting about knowing that somebody who's so loved by her patients is also helping us thinking about design the care centers for the future, and also representing the team, right? I think Whitney's talking about all this work, and there's a little army of people that are working on this. Whitney, I'm gonna ask you one thing, because you talked a lot about the registry, and it's amazing. If people wanna look at that highlights report, or they wanna look at previous registries, how can they get access to that?
They're available online.
There you go.
There we go. And sometimes in person, I don't know if we have any printed versions here. I know sometimes in person they're available. The local chapters have them for different events, but online is probably the easiest way to access that data.
Perfect.
Absolutely.
Look on our website, right, Aaron? We'll have those.
Yep.
As a matter of fact, all the time when I want to go refer to it, I can't find my little book, so I just go on the website and get it that way. It's easier to find. So, Whitney, thank you.
Thank you.
We're really excited that you're part of the team and helping to lead. So our next speaker is another person who may be very familiar with you, but I don't think he's spoken to this group before, and that's Dr. J.P. Clancy. And J.P. is an amazing mixture of knowing clinical work, but also knowing clinical research and basic science. And his background has been everything from running a research center at UAB and then at Cincinnati, to taking care of patients as a pediatric pulmonologist. And JP joined us about 4 years ago to oversee our clinical research efforts to make sure that our clinical trial network is prepared for the future, that we think about how to bring in the academic research to complement the industry research, and to make sure that we're addressing all those things that we say, oh, we need to take care of that and take care of that. And so JP's our Senior Vice President of Clinical Research, been a wonderful mentor to so many in the community. And JP, we're looking forward to you coming up and telling us more about clinical research.
Thank you, Michael, and thank you, everyone. It is so good to be back together again. So I also want you to indulge me for 30 seconds, all right? I'm gonna take a quick video of y'all because we've heard a lot of perspectives from patients, from families, from spouses, but one cool perspective is when you get to stand up here. So your job on three is to go, woo-hoo, and we will get that online, all right? Ready? One, two, three. Awesome. Thank you. So, as Mike said, my name is J.P. Clancy. It's a thrill to be here and to update you a little bit about some of the story behind what Whitney was telling you about. It is really an exciting time in CF research. And I'm going to focus a little bit on the now, and I'm going to be trying to set things up for my dear friend and colleague, Steve. We worked together for a number of years back at UAB, and he's going to tell you really about the future. And so hopefully between our two talks, you can kind of get a sense of where we're going. And the last thing I wanted to say is we're here for you in many ways, because times are going to come up where people want to know stuff, and it's kind of hard to remember all this stuff. So it is absolutely expected that you reach out to us if you have needs to better understand what's going on, so you can speak to the people in the community, to donors, to families, so they give them the hope and have them help understand what our research plans are. So please, please reach out to us. So Whitney showed you this figure, and it's showing amazingly the increase in the number of people with CF, and that increase is primarily in adults in blue, and we now know that CF is dominated by adults. But I wanted to remember or remind you that an awful lot of these advances came by treating the symptoms of CF, the consequences of CF, not the cause. And all those things along the bottom in blue, those are different therapies that treat the symptoms of CF. And you can see they've been associated with steady improvements in outcomes. The world has obviously changed with modulators, but the need for those symptomatic therapies continues. And so I'll give you a little bit more in that, but it's just a message that that's an important reminder of what's going to be, what our research efforts are and continue to be. As mentioned before, when the CF Foundation was established back in the mid-50s, people with CF often didn't even survive to go to school. Today, as we've heard, median survival of 53, and more than half the population are adults. And what you're looking at here across the bottom is lung function of people with CF 20 years ago and today, broken down by different ages. You got your 10-year-olds in blue, you got your 18-year-olds in sort of orangey, or no, green. I always get green and orange messed up. Green, and then over on I hope but you're right, it's kind of the purple and blue, those are the adults, 30 years old. And you can see with each one of those, 2001 to 21, big improvements in lung function across the different groups. But I'm gonna drill down a little bit more in the adult group to really speak to the why we need ongoing symptomatic therapies. This is a snapshot of what we think CF is going to look like over the next 10 to 15 to 20 years. And the registry did some amazing work about 5 years ago to really start thinking about what the future of CF looks like if a large number of patients are on highly effective modulators like Trikafta and so forth. And what we see, this is looking at adult, just numbers of adults with CF, as you march along in five-year blocks, you know, the number of people who are adults with CF is almost gonna, it's gonna go up like 50%. Maybe even more over the next 15 years. And the point is, though, those different colors are sort of different levels where your lungs are. The yellow is very mild disease. The blue, kind of moderate disease. The purple, more advanced disease. And the point of that is there's going to be a lot of people who have lung disease with CF. They're going to be living longer lives, but they're going to have ongoing lung disease. And so we're going to need these symptomatic therapies to help them manage their disease. In addition, for people who are not on modulators, as we search for their cure and their CFTR therapy, their needs are going to continue just like those with more advanced disease. So I'm going to mention just a few programs, and if you want to hear more, we have a breakout, and we'll talk in more detail about that. But I want to let you know, just a snapshot of the now, what are some of the research projects that are going on to fight infections in CF? And the first I'll mention is a term we've heard quite a bit around over the last several years. It's called phage. Phage is a virus that attacks bacteria. You know, when we get a virus, it attacks us. These phages don't attack us. They attack the bacteria, and they're everywhere. We don't even, you know, most of the time, I generally never know that they're there. They are waging their war with bacteria every day, every moment. But people have really, over the last handful of years, tried to really apply what's happening in nature, find those phages, and have them attack the CF infections in unique and special ways. And I list here a few companies who are currently in clinical trials in CF patients trying to treat Pseudomonas infections. And I also highlight that these phage can go, they're not limited to Pseudomonas. They can attack other tough to treat organisms like non-tuberculous mycobacteria. So really an exciting area. We're trying to do this in a rigorous way to understand where does phage fit in that whole treatment algorithm. Next, I want to mention staph, actually the most common infection now that we see in staph. Kind of comes in a couple of flavors, sort of more routine staph and one called MRSA, and methicillin resistant, tends to be more difficult to treat. And we are in the early stages of studying a drug that's been available in other countries, but not in the US, that is able to treat both staph and MRSA. And those studies we envision beginning this year, they're going to be focused on exacerbations and hopefully moving into other studies not too far afterwards. NTM, as I mentioned before, a difficult to treat infection. A couple of really exciting and novel approaches. One is using something called inhaled nitric oxide. Nitric oxide is actually a natural chemical in our bodies, but at high levels can kill bacteria. And an exciting study of being able to use inhaled nitric oxide at home is being conducted, and early safety data looks really promising. Oral amikacin. Amikacin is one of those IV drugs that can cause lots of problems over time. It can cause problems with your kidneys, it can cause problems with hearing and balance. And this really cool idea is trying to turn amikacin, which we usually take IV and needs to can be taken for months if you have NTM infections, into a form that's oral, and you can take it by mouth, and it only works where the infection is, so hopefully it will spare organs that get damaged. So exciting, early days. Hope to give you an update soon. And last, I'll mention fungal infection. This has been raised on a few occasions. Fungal infections are complex to treat, but are clearly a problem in the post-lung transplant population. And we're doing a study of an inhaled antifungal in those who've had transplant to see if it's a good prophylaxis to prevent getting a fungal infection when your immune system is suppressed. I also wanted to highlight some other symptomatic-based treatments, ones that are trying to help make mucus thinner and others that are trying to help reduce the inflammation, which over time causes that loss of lung function over time. And the pictures I'm showing you here is kind of a healthy airway, just a snapshot right above the cells. Those little things standing up, they're called cilia. They're supposed to be extended and standing up and beating the mucus out all day long. And down below is an example of the same picture, but in CF. And you can see all those cilia are smushed, and that sort of big big glob at the bottom is thick mucus sort of sitting on top. And the goal of those types of treatments for mucus is to help it be more watery and easier to clear out. So we're approaching that with sort of two general strategies. One is to try to influence and reduce how salt or sodium is being moved across the airway cells. And two approaches here that are in early phase clinical trials, really helping to promote more water in the mucus so it's easier to clear. The one in the middle is trying to activate a backup chloride channel that's available in everybody. And this approach is really novel. No, it's never been tried before in this way. And it's really, again, trying to sort of supplement your airway's ability to help move that chloride and also move the water. And then I mentioned anti-inflammatories. Again, these are sort of try to take the edge off that beneficial response to infection to keep it at bay, but also damaging response, which can injure the airways over time. And the first is a drug that has recently been tested in a similar disease to CF called non-CF bronchiectasis and seems to show benefit and is now going to be examined in CF patients. And then the one below, fenretinide, is basically a vitamin A derivative, which we know is able to reduce inflammation. And we're currently in the process of reviewing those study results of phase 2. And I think another point to make of all these therapies, they're for anybody. They are definitely for people who are not on modulators. Definitely for people who have ongoing symptoms and are on modulators. So it's really, it doesn't matter. And they just, if you need them, these are the types of things we would like to be able to provide. So I'm showing you a lot of other work that's going on, and I am more than happy to spend time in Q&A, et cetera. But these are studies that are being funded primarily by the CF Foundation. We actually have one of these that's a partnership with the FDA. Better understanding how to treat people with CF in this new era, both people who are on Trikafta, and also many of these are people may or may not be on Trikafta. They're looking at things like better treating and understanding non-tuberculous mycobacteria, how to treat viral infections in younger kids, collecting specimens at home, measuring things at home, which obviously we adapted to with the pandemic, how to treat exacerbations. Do we need two antibiotics? Can we get by with one now? Colon cancer screening. Obviously, we know that in CF there's a much higher risk of GI cancers. Can we make it simpler by doing some stool-based testing? And also CF-related diabetes. And again, I am more than happy to go into details, but it's really also for you to know when that question is raised in the community, we can answer and say, yeah, this is what we're doing, and I think it will be really help scratch an itch that I imagine you run into from time to time. I'm going to spend then just a few minutes speaking around or about studies that are ongoing to better understand CF in this modulator era. Each one of these circles represents a separate clinical trial, and I don't have time to cover every single one in detail. I will call out three of them that I think will be of particular interest. But what I'm showing you here is they're all asking somewhat different questions, and they are including a huge number of people with CF. We estimate well over 7,000, so an amazing number to really better understand what CF is in the new era that we're living in now. And I'm going to start by talking a little bit about PROMISE. You've heard of this study before. It's enrolled well over 500 patients, and it's looking at the impact of Trikafta across a number of different organ systems. It's looking at infection inflammation, GI, liver, lungs, growth, endocrine, and also banking specimens for future research so it can answer additional questions over time. And rather than show you all the improvements that we saw, I think a really valuable snapshot is when somebody's been on Trikafta for, on average, 6 months, how are they? What do their numbers look like? How are they feeling? Well, for this study, that person's about 25 years old. Their lung function's about 90%. Their sweat chloride is below 50, well below the diagnostic level. They're actually getting on the edge of overweight, believe it or not, which was something that sounded unthinkable in the past. And there's almost no symptoms. You know, this isn't everybody, but this is on average what we're seeing for people who've been on Trikafta. Things like, I've gained 25 pounds, I have hope, I haven't been in the hospital, I can smell things. I mean, these are just the day-to-day amazing changes that people are seeing. I then wanted to highlight a second study called Simplify. You probably have heard of that, but it's asking a really pretty simple question. If we take away one of two treatments, or both actually, hypertonic saline, pulmozyme, for a short period of time, 6 weeks, Does that have any impact on lung function and symptoms? This is not answering the long term, but it's at least giving a sense of whether interrupting these established symptomatic therapies cause a problem, and really understand who are and who are not people who should be making changes. And it's really two studies in one, as I mentioned. On the left here, we see this run-in period. Everybody's on hypertonic saline, then they go for 6 weeks, either on or off. And on the other side, same principle, starting on pulmozyme and then on or off for 6 weeks. Results coming very soon. They told me next month, so stay tuned. And I finally will just highlight a study that's asking a similar question, but in a very different way. This is the HERO2 study. It's being led by Kathy Sabadosa and other members of the CFF, and it's really an exciting study that is in very non-touch. It's all virtual. It's all using an app to tell us what, if you're on modulators, what other therapies are you doing? What's your routine looking like? So we can really better understand what decisions people are making in their care right now. And what we're seeing here is just the enrollment over time, and each of the different colors is a different way they found out about the study. And the point is, you know, lots people learn about research in different ways, so we have to adapt to that and offer research in lots of different ways. So I believe that completes my time. I hope that you realize that there is a lot going on in the current world, and it's extremely exciting. We truly are living through a transformative age right now, and we're playing catch up to figure out how do we best take care of people with CF in this current world. How do we continue to develop those new therapies that people on modulators and not on modulators are going to need? And so, Steve's going to be coming after me, and he's going to be talking about what we see down the road, what the exciting things that are on just on the horizon. So thank you. I'm stepping down. Hopefully I wasn't too long. Oh, I got you.
Great job. Well, JP, thank you. And I think we look forward to seeing that video. That's really what we want to see. actually, JP, let me ask you one thing. I know we're going to have questions, but you had phage up there. Obviously, phage is one of the hot words right now. And talk to us just a little bit about where those studies are. Is that something that's just in the dish? Is it actually, you know, what stage are those at?
Yeah, I didn't go into detail for that, but we're in what we call phase one, and even arguably getting into phase two. And what that really means is we're starting to test. We start with a single dose. Is it safe? Is it tolerable? Does it cause any side effects or acute problems when you first give that in sort of increasing doses? And then we're testing, can you give multiple doses? And with those multiple doses, do you start to see benefits like reduction in bacteria, perhaps improvement in lung function, perhaps reduction in symptoms? Probably not quite enough to draw those conclusions, but really kind of give us a guide to really the larger studies, which are going to answer the question, where does phage fit in CF care and research?
Perfect. I'm sure we'll get some additional questions. I've got my magic iPad there, so if you're online or you want to submit questions, keep they're stacking up. We'll definitely address those. Our third talk today is one that's really looking at the future and what we're going to do to address this path to a cure. And I'm actually going to right now just ask, I think, for people who are here who have benefited from Trikafta, it's wonderful, right? This is a time to celebrate. But for people whose loved ones are not able to benefit from the new modulators, who are waiting, this is tough, right? And I can imagine. So this next section is for you, all right? It shows our commitment. I'm actually going to ask if you have somebody, a loved one, or one of your closest friends who's still waiting for a therapy because they can't benefit from the modulators yet. I want you to stand up. This section is for you. We are absolutely committed to making this amazing story be for everybody, right? And so I wanted you to be recognized because I know this is not as easy, and but this section will give you hope. This section is going to give you hope. Our next speaker is somebody I'm really excited for you all to meet. Remember I said before, this might be, he's spending his last few seconds in anonymity before he gets to be known. But I'm going to tell you a little story. So it's Dr. Steve Rowe, our new chief scientific officer. And Steve's very well known in the science community and a dear friend for many of us for many years. Has actually been an advisor to the CF Foundation every Thursday afternoon in our medical strategy meetings for over a decade as an outside advisor. But when Bill Skatch, who's amazing and said to say hello, he'll make an appearance here again sometime in the future. We knew that we were going to need to move to a new chief scientific officer. We started talking who would be best, and we had a lot of internal discussions. And you know, I said I really think that Steve would be the absolute perfect person for this, and everyone agreed. But at the same time, we thought this is a big job. We want to look worldwide, right? We want to be willing to even go outside of CF because we want somebody who can lead us for the future. And so, we hired a very high-powered search firm, a scientific search firm, to really do a world search. And they said, oh, well, the first thing we do is we talk to 10 key opinion leaders from around the world and see what they think and get some. So it was interesting. They came back after the first time. And they said, do you know a guy named Steve Rowe? Why do you say that? So Steve is great. I look forward to you meeting. But his background is as a scientist and as a physician. He's run the research center at the UAB for many years, has been a key leader, actually one of the world's leader in nonsense mutations, developing therapies and the strategy for addressing nonsense mutations, a big chunk of that group that is not able to benefit from modulators currently, as well as really personalized medicine. And on the side, you know, he was the lead investigator for Trikafta. And so is stepping into the position of CSO as of this month, really excited. We've already started. And he's another one who's representing the team. There's a whole army of people focused on this at the foundation. I see Tony Dermowitz sitting here. I think I said Dr. Cara Fauché. There's a team that's focused on all the things we're going to be talking about. You're going to see why when you see that list. So just wanted to say, Steve, we're excited to have you. Welcome to the stage and look forward to hearing.
Well, great. Thank you, Mike. I'm more excited to be here and be among you. It's incredibly energizing. This is, of course, my first VLC, but not my first rodeo for people with CF. I've been working with over a 20-year commitment to patient care, to clinical science, to basic research, and had an opportunity in Birmingham and others to interact with the community, but nothing really has been more motivating than being totally immersed with you about the challenges, about the excitement, but also about what we need to do next. So thank you for that. Thank you for the welcoming. And I look forward to talking to many of you along the way, as we've already done a bit, as the anonymity has worn off. Of course, I'm just coming into this role of CSO, and I just do want to say one other thing personally, is that I am really honored with the responsibility for before us, and promise to do everything in our power as a collective with this amazing team that Mike just spoke to bring our dreams to reality. And so along the way, what I hope to do in the next few minutes is introduce you to some of the challenges that we have before us as we're looking ahead, but also that we have a clear plan to address them and give you the hope as the science is evolving at an incredible pace, along with the landscape for people with CF, and that we are in position to evolve quickly, think fast, and work hard to accomplish our goals. So this, with that respect, it's important to really reflect on the landscape of CFTR modulators, those that we've heard so much about, including the treatments and the amazing effects that we've heard among some of these vignettes along the way. Up to, if you can see in purple, up to 93% of people could ultimately benefit from a highly effective CFTR modulator. And right now, this largely means Trikafta, but I'll show you why there may be other options along the way. Within this first group of our challenge, it's also important to note that 93% is really a theoretical number, and we're not there yet. This is because this is really matched out by the number of people with a specific genes where these respond to. And we know that these are not approved for certain people's individuals, even with these genes. For the first group, of course, is the younger and younger age group that needs to be treated. You may not know that there's obviously clinical trials going on with Trikafta in these youngest individuals to bring it down. The same is true for Kalydeco, as we're treating the youngest infants, 4 month old. And we're starting to see amazing effects from this that we did not conceive, and in fact are changing our paradigm of what can be achieved. For example, people, individuals, babies in this case, that are having their pancreas function restored if we can start treatment early enough. So there's much more work to do here, but there's also individuals, even with the right gene, that are not able to take these medicines. This is because they might have side effects, or they might have other complications of CF that you heard about from Whitney and JP that prevent them from being able to take these medicines, including drug-drug interactions for some of these terrible infections that afflict people with CF. So there's more to do in this area, and I'll speak to that just briefly in the next slide or two. But of course, what is I am speaking to today, in large part, is this group at the top, the individuals that are not having a CFTR modulator treat their CF. Their basic defect is not addressed, and then, of course, this results in this urgent need for us to try and address it. And I hopefully can share with you towards the end of the talk the belief that we, in fact, we are in position to make a big difference, use the roadmap that's been set for these treatable mutations to try and address those for all. And that includes the 3% of individuals, the biggest group of this untreated mutation set, with nonsense mutations, an area that we've had an intense research interest. In fact, was my first experiments in CF, working with JP back at UAB at the time, where it's in fact on nonsense mutations. And so we're continuing to work very hard on this area, and was working on new data last night and the night before as it's emerging from some of our collaboratives. And then second, of course, is these other mutations that are in a wide variety of types that I'll tell you about just briefly that we need to address. But many of those treatments are going to need to come from true genetic therapies. And of course, I'm going to speak to that considerably. So again, pivoting to that group in purple, those that are on CFTR modulators, we are learning a bit. You heard a bit about this from JP. There's while there's clearly big improvements, and you can see that uptick on the very far left of that graph of the improvement that's been seen in lung function, it still slides downward. It still slopes downward in the dark circles. And this really tells us that people who are on Kalydeco, in this case, highly effective modulator therapy that we've observed through this long-term 45-center research study that involved the entire community of CF centers and also extremely dedicated individuals that allow us to do intensive data collection, despite no benefit to them, to help understand what's happening with CF, that the lung disease is still progressing. We will need to do more to try and stop lung disease in its tracks. Modulators have helped, but they're not a cure, so we need to do more. Well, in fact, here's the medical research program that we're now overseeing as a team, and you can see it is growing substantially. There's a big job before us to do this right and do this as best as possible to bring benefits for people with CF. You can see it's grown over time to this impressive number of 250 million or more in 2021. And we thank the sorts of individuals that are running our milestones programs and others among the chapters that help make this possible. This includes investments in our basic research. This is now more important than ever as we start to pivot towards genetic therapies where there is a considerable amount of unknowns that we have to understand to be able to do this well in the lung and the other organs that are affected by CF. We just had a summer research conference where we're bringing in all sorts of new investigators, many of whom were new to CF in the last year or two, as they pivot their ideas in genetic therapies to try and understand basic aspects of CF. But of course, there's also a cornerstone research in other areas that you hear about frequently. The drug discovery and development programs that we just spoke to, clinical and real world research that both Whitney and JP talked about, as well as the care improvement that you'll hear throughout the conference. This is an overview of the drug development pipeline. You've probably seen it many times. I just want to use it to point out that, just like JP pointed out, there is an extensive amount of effort going on to try and understand and treat with these new treatments for people with CF. And before we jump into PTAC therapies as a whole, I just want to point out that everything that's not in purple involves supportive therapies for people with CF that still have important infections in yellow, or other complications in CF, such as in green, blue, and dark blue. And that remains extensive. And we have an entire team of individuals in an upcoming platform session to complement the session yesterday to talk about how we're going to develop anti-infective therapies for people with CF. But of course, I've been asked to really focus in on the group in purple, the path to a cure type therapies. This includes a number of CFTR modulators. That's on the far left. Those bars are a little further along because we know what we're doing. And we have a clear path to bring them forward, and that's already progressing rapidly. As well as the sorts of genetic therapies that are all reaching the late phase of basic research development that is going to allow them to go into patients, and I'll summarize some of that going forward. But first, on the far left, those new modulator programs that we're trying to develop to give more options for people with CF and improve on Trikafta even further, to halt that lung disease progression in its tracks. You can see there's really three major programs that we're still investing in. This represents the best of the best. A few years ago, we had more like 11 programs. These are the ones that have risen to the top to offer something that we believe could be even more beneficial than our current therapies. And that includes programs by Vertex, including a once daily pill for people with CF, as well as earlier programs, both AbbVie and recently announced just in the last year with Siona, that have new mechanisms to bring to bear, to bring more CFTR to the surface, to bring the most function out of CFTR, to bring that sweat chloride down even further and restore health for people with CF. Well, another approach to this is to try and address these more difficult to treat mutations that are not treated. And one is to, again, use the roadmap that we are now understand. And that is by modulator-like drugs for the protein. But these are a harder a bit. And I'll speak to that just a bit. One is, of course, the read-through agents that Mike already introduced, as well as antisense oligonucleotides, short, basically DNA or RNA particles that are intended to interact with the gene without permanently modifying it. These have the potential to offer hope for people with nonsense mutations, and we're investing in those programs. That includes the program with Elox, which uses a custom-designed aminoglycoside. This is basically like the tobramycin and gentamicin that people with CF use almost all the time, but designed instead to induce read-through of a premature termination codon, to cause the gene to be ignored and allow a full-length protein to be produced. We also have basic work programs in this area that are on this slide, including Southern Research that actually interacts on a regular basis with our lab. That's some of the data I spoke to that we're looking at most recently, as well as Icagen. What I can tell you is that now we have multi-drug molecule combinations, all intended to do the same thing, to improve the read-through and to do so without affecting other genes. And what I can say now is that we now have 2 and 3 drug combinations that are achieving the thresholds of activity that we believe we will need to see clinical effects in the clinic. Now our challenge before us is to turn in those into drugs, but I think with the appropriate investment and teamwork of the community and the research researchers that we built, we will have a real opportunity to do this. And that's why, even though it's still early, we are really trying to exploit with maximum benefit the sort of results that were announced in the last year. And that is that people with nonsense mutations that are taking a read-through drug actually have a small improvement in their sweat chloride. So now the CF Foundation is taking upon that to fund additional research to try and add on correctors and potentiators to get the most out of that benefit. We will know we have to do much more to get the kind of clinical effects that we expect for people with CF, but this really provides that initial proof of concept that this might be possible. Well, of course, the other approach is the path to a cure. You already know that this is an ambitious agenda to treat the underlying cause of CF and ultimately deliver the one-time cure. There's been $500 million that's initially allocated for 2025. With your help, we know we will be able to extend this to get the job done completely. It's really been a challenge to accelerate the pace of progress with these innovative academic and industry collaborations and to pursue genetic therapies with the promise of accelerating them for all people with CF. I think one thing that really harkens back to me is that we are in a new era of medicine. Many of, with all of the news to digest right now, this may have passed you by. There are now genetic therapies where we can take people with a genetic cause of blindness, give them a single injection of a new DNA molecule, and it can permanently replace the gene within the eye so that somebody who could not see can read the newspaper. This is the new era of genetic therapies for the CF. Now, in the eye, the reason this was done first is that it's a much easier target. You can take a needle and put that single drug in the eye. And if things go wrong, of course, we're born with two eyes. So that was a perfect scenario to test this sort of a problem. It's also immune privileged, so that the immune system is not nearly as complex as the lung, which is really designed to keep out bacteria, other pathogens, things that we inhale on a regular basis. We have to learn how to combat all of that. But I don't think you can hear this sort of news that it's happening in the eye, also in the blood, for blood-borne diseases, that genetic therapy can in fact be achieved, and that CF should be among the first diseases of the lung where this is accomplished beyond these easier to target organs. And that's what we're all about in the years ahead. So if we start to think about ensuring these transformative treatments for all mutations, this really slide summarizes it all. Includes CF mutations for traditional therapy, CF manifestations for traditional therapy, and then the sorts of protein repair therapies that we all know well now in CFTR modulators. And with path to a cure, the major emphasis is on both RNA and DNA treatments to try and treat the underlying cause and replace the abnormal mutations that are causing disease in people with CF. For RNA, we normally think of nonsense read-through, mRNA treatments, as well as these short oligonucleotides to try and repair the RNA. And when we think about DNA treatments, we're talking about gene delivery as well as the gene editing approaches to swap and replace the abnormal gene in people with CF. So this is the landscape. I think you've seen this slide yesterday, briefly over 60 funded and potentially funded industry programs across the broad spectrum of challenges that we have to address to bring this. On the far left, we're talking about CFTR restoration for nonsense mutations, mRNA and oligonucleotides, as well as other programs. Next, we're talking about the gene delivery programs, including uses viruses custom designed to deliver the CFTR gene to the right cells, as well as non-viral approaches where you use other technologies to bring this to bear. Finally, there's 13 programs in gene editing, which again is, illustrates the concept of swap and replace. And in fact, that this is being done for other diseases, as I spoke to, both in the eye and the blood. We are quite encouraged that with the appropriate science and investigation, that this might also be possible in the lung. And of course, we're going to need models and tools and other initiatives to try and bring this to bear. Mike spoke one or two lines about this yesterday, including innovative partnerships with the best venture philanthropy firms, like Longwood and Pioneering and others, to try and bring new partners to help us accomplish this. And we're already having many new ideas come to the table as they work hand in hand with us. It also, because we're bringing in new people that don't think about CF until now, that puts the impetus on us to build an amazing team, which we've already done, and it will continue to expand as the breadth of our research program generates. And I hope you'll join us for some of the breakout sessions later today, where you'll hear about some of our team members as we try to accomplish these goals. Well, what is the landscape looking? How can I bring this to more reality and not just conceptually? I hope to do that in the next few slides before I step down. One is mRNA delivery. In fact, we have a lot of hope with this. We have a lot of hope with this in part because of amazing advances that have been made with mRNA therapy. I suspect that, like me, many of you have participated in mRNA treatments to try and protect yourself from COVID. And in fact, we believe that instead of delivering a COVID protein, we can deliver the CF reactive protein with this message and have people inhale it, perhaps on a weekly basis, to ultimately deliver it principally to the lung. We'll have to make sure that it goes to the right cells, that they take it up in sufficient quantity and avoid the immune system on the way in. It won't be a permanent cure, but it has the potential to be used by people no matter their mutation. And obviously, because of this, the science that is advanced with mRNA therapy, we're quite bullish on this. And in fact, there are studies that have already been completed where there were some learnings and several more that are on the way. The second would be the idea of gene transfer. This is where we use a virus or other technologies to deliver the whole CFTR gene or the functional part of the CFTR gene in the middle of the DNA, not necessarily in a spot and not where it's normally expressed, and not necessarily swapping out the previous protein. This, again, will be targeted to the lungs at first. We know it doesn't have the likelihood of lasting forever because the cells in the lung turn over on a regular basis. But if we can get it to the cells that need CFTR, get through, again, the immune system and the mucus barrier, it has the potential to be a treatment that doesn't rely on mRNA. It won't be a permanent cure, again, because of this turnover, but we believe it will have a potential for pronounced effect. And in fact, there are trials ongoing already now. They started enrolling where we're having our first attempts at this. And then finally, the ultimate dream. The ultimate dream that I spoke to in that example of gene editing. There's a lot more unknown for the lung, but the vision for this is that it could be done systemically. It could be injected, for example, into the blood, go to all the organs that are affected by the CFTR gene, swap out. It avoids some challenges like having to figure out which cells need it, because even if it goes to a cell where it's not otherwise needed, the body will know what to do with it because we're putting the normal gene right back into the place where the abnormal gene exists. And it represents the potential for the permanent cure. So this is why this is such an emphasis. This breaks this down. For those of you that want a little bit more about this, of course, within the cell, we have the CFTR DNA that makes the mRNA that ultimately results in the protein that goes to the cell surface and then acts as the functional channel, the door that we all knew that moves salt and water to make our mucus and host defense properties more normal. If we layer in, of course, modulators affect the protein function or help it bring to the surface, mRNA replacement would be in this intermediate step. This is why we're a little further advanced in this area because it's a little bit simpler to do. And then ultimately DNA replacement or editing. And of course, our first destination for this type of drug is the lung because of the manifestations that we all know affect there. But we will not stop there. Again, thinking about the gene editing and systemic treatments that will be beyond. So what are we doing specifically? Here's some of the genetic technologies that are replacing mRNA that we're already heavily invested in. That includes programs by Vertex, by Arcturus, and by Recode that are all either in startup or in late preclinical, where we can imagine startup occurring with a few final steps of research that needs to be conducted in the next year. And then as we think about gene editing, this is a little bit more about the challenges. Whether we're doing the first kind, gene transfer, or the second kind, the gene swap and replace or gene editing, we have two major challenges. That includes delivering this DNA with the right vehicle, that's essentially the right cargo carrier, to allow it to last long enough and to figure out the ways that it needs to get through these mucus barriers with the delivery route. We also have to target the correct cells. I'll have a slide on that coming, but we, in fact, we need to know which organs this is going to, with our ultimate vision that we could have a substantial benefit if we just do the lung, but ultimately we want the entire body. So we can say that CF stands for cure found. Well, one of the areas that we're really boning up, because we know it's going to be a big challenge, certainly different than the eye, is that we're going to have to target the right cells. There's been a brand new technology that really just came to fruition in the last 5 years, where you can take individual cells, sequence each one of them individually, do this for thousands and thousands of cells, and then understand that there are different cell types with the lung, and they have very different functions depending on what they express. We didn't even know that this could be done 5 years ago, and now we're putting this together with amazing scientists and informatics experts to put together the picture. And in fact, we've learned quite a bit that's quite relevant to the treatment of CF by these sorts of genetic therapies, in that while we all know and think about the ciliated cells that JP showed earlier that beat to move the mucus and move out the pathogens, that's not where CFTR is. And in fact, it's other cell types where the CFTR is most relevant, including the secretory cells, the basal cells that are responsible for making more cells to follow, and these very rare but special cell types called ionocytes, where there's loads of CFTR. So we're using this to understand how we get into one cell but not the other, and how we get through the mucus barrier that sits on top to do that. Well, one approach to this is to use viruses, which are already obviously designed by nature to get into the epithelium, so we can then customize them to deliver the CFTR gene without causing injury. And we have three programs that are all in either early startup, in progress, or in the late preclinical stages. So with that, I'm gonna wrap up in my last slide and just remind you about what's different today and why we should be optimistic about genetic therapies in the future. For first, of course, this is success stories. We understand the roadmap of what it means to turn on the switch where we go from having CF to having something less than CF by turning on the function of the protein. And then we know that there's been huge success stories. I summarized just one of them, but there are many others in these other diseases that are listed that are easier to deal with than CF, but provide the concept that this, in fact, can be done. And we have more tools in our toolbox to do this. They're listed here. I won't read them, but we are really investing heavily and bringing in the researchers that are active in these areas to help us address these tools. And of course, I've summarized all along the way these new sorts of approaches, including mRNA, stem cell-based therapies that we haven't had time to address today, but I'm certainly happy to talk to you later, as well as gene editing. So with that, I'll end. Let Mike take the floor, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you for that, Steve. And maybe I'll ask one quick question, and I'm going to sit down as well. I'm going to apologize when I sit down because I won't be able to see this group. Hopefully you'll be able to see me on the screen there. How about that? You talked about a lot of different areas, and we got lots of work to do. We're excited that the team's here to do that. Which of those is sort of the closest to actually really being something where people say, hey, this is a therapy? So, you know, RNA, DNA, ASOs, gene editing, what's the ones that you feel like, hey, this is actually probably the first thing that we're going to be seeing moving forward?
Yeah, I mean, I think we interpret that in the context of which ones are actually moving into clinical trials where we're going to get readouts that could really inform which ones have the most hope and where to lean in. And of course, I think the one that rises to the top to me are the mRNA delivery, because there's already been one trial that's finished where we had important learnings, and several others that are starting up right now where there's going to be learnings on the way. So that's one. Now, oligonucleotide therapy, very targeted to specific mutations such as splice mutations is another. We didn't have time to talk about the details today, but it represents something similar where we're putting in a small RNA molecule to try and modulate the problem. And those trials will also be beginning in the year ahead. So this is where we're going to have our first sets of learnings while we do the science needed for the sorts of permanent treatments that are ahead.
Perfect. I'll ask you one more because I'm going through the list here. And that are there initiatives searching for solutions for those who can't take Trikafta because it causes liver problems? So somebody who could be eligible but not able to take it, and JP may be able to chip in as well here. But you want to talk a little bit about what might be a path forward for that?
Sure. I tried to start with the fact that we are cognizant that not everyone with on the gene listing for a CFTR modulator is able to benefit them for several reasons, and liver disease is among them on the comorbidity list. So different drugs have different effects, side effects, and this is why it's important to have an armamentarium of CFTR modulators that can be brought to bear. And this is why that even though we are all ecstatic about the success that has been observed with Trikafta, that we need to do more. So obviously I spoke to three programs that are all advancing different CFTR modulators that will have the potential to give us the flexibility to use these in different individuals depending on how responsive their mutation is to that complex, or perhaps the sorts of things that you just said, the side effect profile or the drug-drug interactions that influence a choice to take a certain medicine or another with patients and their doctors.
Perfect. We'll keep moving down the next. And so, JP, we did get some more phage questions.
Oh, big surprise.
People were sort of trying to understand the difference between the different programs. Why do we need most of those? Yeah. It's actually somebody who's been doing homework because they asked about cocktail. do you want to talk a little about the different types of phage approaches?
Yeah,
we need those many?
No, it's a great question because, this is been an area of great interest. In fact, one of our speakers from the CF community yesterday, Ella Balasso, has been very involved, and she's actually received phage trying to treat her difficult-to-treat infection. So lots of learning needed. A given phage, or whatever, little phage and his little phage babies, whatever you want to call them, they go after one very specific target within, like, Pseudomonas. It won't go for all the Pseudomonas. It just goes for the Pseudomonas who have sort of maybe, I don't know, a little recognition signal on them. And so these cocktails try to put together a number of different phages that all go, for example, after Pseudomonas, but they go for different targets within Pseudomonas. And so these different programs have different mixtures. Again, most of these come from nature, which is really fascinating. They're out there, and we obviously just didn't know much about them in great detail, but they are out there. And that's the vast majority of work happening right now. There's also, though, the capacity to actually engineer the phage, in other words, tell it to go after a target as opposed to find ones that naturally go after a target. And that's another strategy that's being taken. So those are just high level, general approach, but different cocktails, different engineering strategies.
Different mix of perfect. Maybe one more for you, and that is, you mentioned the HERO study.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And can anyone join the HERO study, or is that center specific? Do you know the answer to that?
It is primarily for people who are on Trikafta to better understand how they're doing their other therapies. And I think it's actually may have actually completed enrollment, so which is exciting. That being said, there are a lot of programs that sort of interface between research and care, trying to better understand how to use apps to understand, to track your own care and track your own utilization. And in fact, I might even ask my partner, Whitney, does that anything ring a bell about how people are using apps in their daily care?
Yeah, absolutely. I was just thinking that while you were saying it. The idea of getting data back to us without having the clinic interface necessarily, so we can get more frequent reporting of how someone's doing. So I think the technology is something that we're working together and trying to build in terms of doing spirometry reliably, getting high quality data, mailing in cultures, tracking activity levels. I left my watch on the table there, but I love my watch and track my steps. Those kind of wearable devices, I think all of that is really ripe for sharing and for learning.
Perfect. And I think it was Pam Baker who had a question about the enrolling part, and I think I specifically wanted to give a call out to the clinical trials finder, the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation's clinical trials finder. It's as good a sort of research opportunity finder as you're going to find anywhere. If you Google, you know, Cystic Fibrosis Clinical Trial Finder, you can actually look at the eligibility criteria. You can see whether or not your own center is doing that. You can search by certain topics, whether it's genetic technologies or it's infections. And then you can also actually send an email to the centers that are doing it saying, hey, I'm interested. So it's a way of really being able to dig down if you're interested. Whitney, I'm going to ask you one, which I think is a great question, which is people, as we're seeing adults living longer, are there things that we're starting to say, hey, we're going to need to pay more attention in this area because maybe we didn't see this as much before, or there's sort of new things that are emerging with the adult population that we need to pay extra attention to?
Yes, absolutely. And I think a couple of cases were shared at the North American CF Conference last fall that highlighted these issues of aging that we really hadn't considered. And one of them is coronary artery disease, mm-hmm. for example. There was, I think, two or three cases where older patients had come in with heart attacks, essentially, and that wasn't necessarily on the top five things that we worry about in terms of taking care of people with CF. So realizing high cholesterol, high blood pressure, heart disease, that we need to think beyond, we really need to get in the mode of thinking like a marathon, not like a sprint, and keeping, you know, and not so much tunnel vision on CF and its complications, but as people age, being very, very holistic and open to treating them just as we treat every other patient and everything right. that can come down the line.
Maybe this is a group effort, which is says most of my problems are more related to nutritional or GI issues. What are we learning about this? Are there any studies going on? Anyway, talk a little bit about GI nutritional issues and studies. So I know, JP, you want to kick us off?
Yeah, I'm certainly happy to get started, and please jump in with others. It's a lot of territory, to be honest with you. We've learned that part of the PROMISE study, there's a sub-study that was really focused on better understanding whether GI symptoms were improved with modulators. And even predating that was a study called GALAXY that really helped us identify some of the PROs, patient-reported outcomes, questionnaires that sort of give us a handle on day-to-day symptoms that people with CF have. And that first study, GALAXY, helped us define them and how they perform and what they look like in people with CF. And then they've been applied in the PROMISE study. And a short answer is for when you're looking at patients, particularly the little bit older patient population, there's not a huge change, honestly, and at least in our experience yet, with symptoms in people who have started Trikafta. And I guess it's not surprising because they've often had a lifetime of sort of GI problems that maybe over time has sort of led to a GI system that doesn't work quite as well. These types of studies now are going into younger populations to help us better understand if earlier use of these drugs can also help to alleviate some of the GI symptomatology. The only other thing I'll mention is that we've also obviously learned that for some people who start Trikafta, nutrition is a problem in a new way with over-nutrition, overweight, and even obesity, which obviously we worry about because it certainly could imply that over time they could have the downstream negative effects of obesity. And that really helps, makes us think carefully about what are the right types of diets, what are the nutritional recommendations, and also what's the relationship between nutrition today and outcomes in CF. And so we are doing a multi-center study called Strong CF, which is really focused on understanding what aspects of nutrition relate to other organ manifestations, lung function, risk for diabetes, things like that. So definitely an area of a lot of research honestly needing to ask questions in a new way simply because the playing field has changed so much so fast. Feel free to jump in if there's other.
Well,
I think on the care center front, mm-hmm. when looking at nutrition, we are seeing signals. We're seeing people with CF come into clinic with different concerns now, like the comment on the screen, 25 pounds of weight gain on Trikafta, et cetera. But we're the dietitian as part of the team, and all of us are really changing our focus to not just send that message of more calories, doesn't matter what they are, just have more calories. We're having to really pivot, and people with CF are recognizing changing their diet, mm-hmm. making long, you know, really again for that marathon, not the sprint. And so we're learning, and as we counsel patients, there may be expanded roles for other medicines to treat diabetes, not just insulin. We may be able to think outside of the box, some medications that may actually help mitigate weight gain. So a lot going on in that space.
Yeah, and we absolutely must do well in this area, because what we don't want people to do is take less CFTR modulator than they otherwise need to keep their lungs healthy because of other things like weight.
Right.
Instead, let's get the weight problem under control and allow them to benefit from as they should from the CFTR modulator therapy.
All right, Steve, I'm going to ask you one question. I'm going to ask you guys to finish this up by telling us what you're most excited about for the next year. All right? And not short and sweet. But Steve, tell us just real quickly. Actually, no, why don't we just go with that? Why don't we just say, what are the things that you're most excited about as you think about this upcoming year or two that you're jazzed about that we're going to be working on?
Well, I mean, there's so much, right? So I think the point of keeping it short and sweet, probably for me. But I think as we pivot towards these sorts of unbelievably exciting genetic therapies, how we're going to build those learnings in and build an evolving team to maximally utilize that the knowledge that's gaining and apply that to people for CF. And we're going to see that in two or three different ways. I've spoken to some in the next year, and in the 2 years ahead, even more. So that's what I'm excited about.
Yes, JP.
Didn't go here today, but engaging new people in research who haven't in the past. It's historically, a lot of our research has been somewhat sort of limited in ways to those sites that have big research programs. TDN obviously is one example of network. I want to go beyond those borders. I want to make access to research open to people who are receiving care outside of TDN centers, and also bringing in new populations who haven't been in research in the same way, people of color, people who have different disease manifestations and perhaps may don't understand their role in research. So to me, that's the big thing. That's my bullseye for the next year.
Fantastic. Whitney, bring us home.
Yes, we issued a call for applications earlier this year for multiple care teams around the country to work together and try to figure out pragmatically what's going to work in terms of, we talked about those remote tools, innovative ways for us to communicate and bolster our care from a distance in some cases, or just enhancing the care that we provide. So we have 9 different teams of multiple centers across the country that have submitted proposals to see how we're going to actually do this in clinic and enhance the care that we deliver and ensure that we have high quality data and best practices in telehealth. So that we're going to be funding that later this year. So looking
Great.
Forward to that.
Well, you know what? It is exciting to hear. I just want to say thank you guys for your leadership, and we look forward to good things ahead.